So it's my great pleasure to introduce Umesh Vazirani. Umesh is the director of the Berkeley Quantum Computing Center, a winner of the Fulkerson Prize, and an author of my favorite textbook on algorithms. I'm actually an academic descendant of Umesh. He's my advisor's advisor. But I've never collaborated with Umesh on anything technical. And still, I feel like I've learned a lot from Umesh just by having casual conversations with him over the years. And I wanted to mention that I think the most important thing I've learned from Umesh is something that he's taught me by way of example, which is he's taught me the immense value of just maintaining an attitude of curiosity about everything. He's always curious. And I'm looking forward to hearing what he's curious about today. So before we start, let me just say the way we'll handle questions today is while Umesh is speaking, you can post your questions in the chat. And if there's a good stopping point, then I will interrupt him to have him address the questions that you posted. And then at the end of the talk, we'll again have another session for questions. So with that, take it away, Umesh.
Great. Thanks a lot, Anup. That's for a really nice introduction. So it's and thanks everyone for showing up. It's really nice to visit. I guess e-visit Yuda. So let's see. I wanted to start this talk by revisiting the big headline from a couple of years ago, headline about the Google experiment, where they, where they showed a massive speed up over classical computers of some task. I want to revisit it by saying, okay, let's look at it 2 years later. And let's try to understand the significance. What's actually even the meaning of this experiment? What's happened since? Does it seem as significant now, less significant, more significant? What are the challenges ahead? And maybe even in the even more important in the process, I want to say, okay, what's the bigger picture around this experiment? And then where do we go from there? Okay, so if while we are talking about the bigger picture, I think it's, let me jump to the a really big picture and, go back to Newton or, this worldview that started with Newton, but of course gained, gained more and more steam over the years as we went into the Industrial Revolution. This was this notion of the mechanical universe or the clockwork universe. And, this was something born in physics, but then it pervaded our entire thinking, the way we viewed the world. So let me try to say a little bit more about, put my finger on what this view of the world is and why it's important for us in computing. So the reason it's important for us in computing is that our entire conception of computers before quantum computers rested on this view, right? So what's this view? Well, this view is, you could try to distill it down by saying nature is described by local differential equations, which means that every point in space minds its own business, just looks around at its infinitesimal neighborhood to decide what to do next. So there's no action at a distance, that's all that matters. And so if you're going to take this view that if you're going to let's now discretize this view. So if we were to make an assumption, if we were to say, what does this look like in a discrete space and time? Well, then it looks like a cellular automaton, and of course, a cellular automaton is equivalent to a Turing machine. So that's where our model of computing comes from. If we were to say, where does it come from physically? And of course, then we can say, well, from there, inevitably, we are led to the extended chair Turing thesis. It says that any reasonable model of computing can be simulated on a probabilistic Turing machine with polynomial simulation overhead. So you know, in this sense, you know, this model of computing that we've been working with is a distillation of centuries of physics. You know, it's the ultimate, you know, it's sort of the you know, in a sense, you know, if one were looking from a parochial viewpoint, one could say, well, this is what physics was ultimately aspiring to. You know, this is sort of the distillation of it. Except, of course, that, you know, this is really not true at all. And the sense in which it's not true at all is that in quantum mechanics, every point doesn't mind its own business. So what you have is, if you have a system of n particles, then associated with it, you know, so if you want to understand what's the state associated with it, you cannot really assign a state to each of these particles. What you have to do is you assign a state to the n particles together, and that's the state in an exponentially large complex Hilbert space. Okay, so the state of these n particles is a unit vector, you know, it's a 2 to the n dimensional complex vector. So there are 2 to the n complex numbers that describe the state. And the state now becomes a unit vector in a 2 to the n dimensional complex vector space. And now, if we were to think about what happens to locality, well, if you were to take 2 of these qubits and interact them with each other, so if you perform some transformation on them, then essentially what happens is this entire 2 to the n dimensional Hilbert space rotates. And together with it, this 2 to the n dimensional vector rotates to, you know, so each of its 2 to the n coordinates takes on a new value. So this, you know, so the point is that this is an extravagant amount of work. The problem is that there's one more axiom of quantum mechanics, which sort of says, well, yeah, it might be the case that there's this exponential amount of work happening behind the scenes, but you don't have access to it. So if you're going to, you know, in order to know what's happening behind the scenes, you have to measure. And when you measure, you only see an n-bit string. And so your n-bit string is chosen from this probability distribution, where if the complex amplitude of the string X, the n-bit string X was alpha sub X, then you see X with probability alpha X magnitude squared. Okay, so this was the subject of you know, this very beautiful paper by Richard Feynman from 1981, called Simulating Physics on a Computer. And in this paper, he pointed out that you apparently need exponential resources to simulate an n qubit quantum system. And then he asked, is this inherent? Or is it possible that there's some different description of quantum systems which can be efficiently simulated? And then he went on to say, well, if not, you know, couldn't you create a computer based on quantum principles to simulate, to perform such simulations efficiently? Right? So, you know, this paper was actually more or less the transcript of a talk that he gave at a workshop. I think the workshop was maybe a year or two earlier than that. But then in following this paper in the decade or so after that, this paper was largely forgotten. And then it was discovered in the computer science community about in the early 90s. And then, you know, and then we realized that in fact, this was something that violated this extended chair Turing thesis. And so there were three aspects to this violation. You know, one was You have to show that these are programmable computers. You have to show that they are digital. And you have to show that they speed up something, you know, more than polynomially. So in a sense, you know, so the earliest demonstration of this was not very, very, you know, it was sort of, you know, it was rather theoretical and not very, you know, it in some sense didn't have the best kind of bounds. And so in a sense, what one can say is that where we are experimentally is we are trying to recapitulate these very early steps showing the violation of the extended shrink thesis. So in a sense, this Google experiment was trying to recapitulate these first steps at showing that the quantum model of computing is more powerful. But then very shortly thereafter, there were much better ways of showing theoretically this violation of the extended Church-Turing thesis. So for example, of course, there was Shor's algorithms which showed that you could get exponential speedups not just for challenge problems, but for practical problems like factoring and discrete law. There were ways of showing that quantum computers were digital with respect to constant error rate, so that you could get fault-tolerant quantum computers which could compute even in the presence of you know, a constant rate of noise. And then in terms of programmability, there was a new model that was introduced maybe a few years later, which was that instead of thinking about quantum Turing machines or quantum circuits, you could really think about a quantum register that was controlled by a classical computer from the outside. And these really completely, you know, these made, you know, created the model, you know, as we know it today. Now, there's one thing that I should come back to, which is this fact that when you measure your n qubit system, you can get you get at most n classical bits of information. So this is something that can be shown in great generality, even not just when you have your n qubits, but even when you add more ancilla qubits and you try to measure these together. This is something known as Hulervaux's theorem. So there seems to be this fundamental limit that you cannot extract more than n classical bits of information from the state of n qubits. And this is a fundamental limitation that makes, you know, this is one reason that quantum algorithms must inherently look nothing at all like classical algorithms when they're making use of this exponential computing power that lies behind the scenes in this of this quantum computer. Okay, so now even in the early days, I think we realized that there was something very interesting that happens when we look at the fact that there are computations that can be speeded up exponentially compared to this Hulervaux's theorem, which says that you cannot get more information out. And so for example, you know, here's something that I was actually quite surprised to see that we had even articulated it back then. But it said, you know, one might naively argue that it's impossible to experimentally verify the exponentially large size of a Hilbert space associated with a discrete quantum system, right? Since any observation leads to this collapse of the superposition. But then if you have an experiment demonstrating the exponential speedup offered by a quantum computation, this would indirect, you know, this would establish that something like an exponentially large Hilbert space must exist. So why is this interesting? Well, you could sort of say, you know, this exponential growth, you know, this exponential growth of Hilbert space or the exponential amount of computation is arguably one of the most counterintuitive aspects of quantum mechanics. And when you look at what you do in physics, you know, one of the things that you do is you try to test the limits of your theory, you know, to check whether your theory holds in as you look at it in certain limits. So for example, in the limit of very high energy, or in the limit of very, very tiny sizes, or in the limit of very large velocities. And often when these limits are explored, something very new is observed. And so there's a new limit in which to test physics, which is this limit of high complexity. So is it, you know, so we know that quantum mechanics holds to exquisite precision when you look at single particle quantum mechanics, or it holds to exquisite precision when you have these so-called loophole free Bell inequality violations, which test entanglement at a, you know, of single particles. But what about this regime of high complexity? And this is where this experiment from 2 years ago shows up.
Umesh, you know, can I interrupt to ask a question?
Yes.
So I think maybe your description suggests that it's sort of we can't get access to the via classical means of the full power of the quantum world. But I just want to point out that most of the things we want to compute, actually the answers are only n bits long. So you're not suggesting that it's hard to compute hard
no
problem.
What I'm suggesting is that this bottleneck, this data bottleneck, plays a very important role in the design of algorithms. So you've got to figure out how to take your information and load it into this exponentially large space, and then how to make it interfere to get that small piece of information out. So somehow it's your algorithm has to distribute this information into this exponentially large space and then refocus it down. And so that's the, you know, this style of you know, the design of quantum algorithms is sort of it's dictated by those considerations. But that's all I was saying. Okay, so now if you look at Google's experiment, you know, it was a 52 qubit experiment, maybe 51, probes a 2^52 dimensional Hilbert space. And in it, what they were doing was, you know, they were choosing a number of qubits. Well, first of all, it's how many they had at the time, but it was also a number that was large enough so that 2^n is impressive, small enough so it can be simulated by a classical supercomputer. And if you look at a cartoon depiction of the experiment, it was like this. You know, you had your qubits, which were being controlled by a classical computer. You had your input, all zeros. You measure classical output. It's a classical output distributed according to a probability distribution. So if you repeat the experiment over and over again, you get different outputs, right? And so now, what can you do with it? Well, all you could do, you know, so what they were trying to do was check whether the output has a quantum accent. You know, so they want to know in here, is this quantum or classical? And so basically you see the output from the distribution, and you want to, from listening to this device talk for a little while, you want to say, is this a quantum accent? Is it a classical accent? Okay, and there were a few aspects of this experiment. One is it took them exponential time to detect whether it had a quantum accent. At the end of the day, we don't know for certain that classical computers cannot fake such an accent, whatever they were detecting. There was some evidence that they cannot. And so now we can try to now that so much time has passed, we can see how well did they do on each of these and what we can do in future. Okay, so just to very quickly go over the experiment, I'll just talk about it for the next 5 minutes, and then I'll move on to other stuff. So what were they actually doing? So they picked a random quantum circuit C of depth about 20. You know, this was their chip with these other qubits. Those were the adjustable couplers, which your classical computer could adjust. And so you had your qubits interacting with each other at each step. And then after each step, they interacted in a different way and so on up to depth 20. And then at the end of this 20 depth interaction, you measure all the qubits, you see an output string X. And now you use a classical supercomputer to compute what's the probability that your quantum computer, quantum circuit should have output X. And you repeat this experiment a million times, so you have a million such strings X together with their with the probability they should have been output. And now you want to understand, was it really consistent with this particular circuit? So how do you do that? So the measure that was used was called linear cross entropy, which is just the expected value of the probability that the circuit outputs X. The intuition is that the higher probability X's should show up more often. So this expected value that you observe should be higher than, you know, should be relatively high. So there's a calculation which shows that for a random quantum circuit, this expected value should be 2/2 to the n. For reference, if C output a uniformly random string, then of course the probability of each X being output would be 1/2 to the n. So this expected value should be 1/2 to the n for that case. And so what they wanted to check was that this expected value was actually 2/2 to the n. What they actually saw was that the experiment gave an estimate of 1.002/2 to the n. And so now you could sort of say, well, how convincing was this? And what they were claiming was it was very convincing for various reasons, you know, some hand waving, et cetera, but the fact that they repeated the experiment millions of times gave them some, you know, that's why they believed that this 1.002 was significant. So now in terms of theoretical justification, there were two kinds of justifications. One, which was based on complexity theoretic reasons, showed that, you know, if said roughly, you know, these are rough statements, if a polynomial time classical circuit can output from a distribution extremely close to this output distribution of a random quantum circuit, then the polynomial hierarchy collapses. Okay, but so the problem with this kind of statement is this extremely close to, right? The experiment doesn't go extremely close in any way. So, you know, this is sort of a distant justification. This distant justification has since been improved by a number of authors, but it's still in this range of extremely close. There was a second kind of justification, which was given by Aronson Chen and Aronson Gunn. And this was in the style of fine-grained complexity. So they came up with this hypothesis, you know, they tried to formalize this notion that a quantum circuit often generates heavy outputs with high probability, which have a higher probability under the quantum circuit. And so their hypothesis was that there's no efficient classical algorithm that can guess with probability half plus exponentially small, given an output X, whether it's below median probability or above median probability for that quantum circuit. Okay. And under some slight variance of this hypothesis, they were able to show that in fact the experiment was, you know, it could not be duplicated classically. So this was good evidence, but of course the assumption is a pretty strong assumption. So for example, if you use the Feynman path integral or just path, you know, computing over all you know, just trying a random path down the computational path, then you can sort of, you know, get almost as good as this bound. So this was sort of making a very fine distinction here. Now, in recent times, you know, recently the attempts at spoofing this experiment have gone quite, you know, have improved quite a bit. So there have been attempts to spoof it over the last 2 years. But the most recent one is actually extremely convincing. This is by Pan Chen and Zhang from a few months ago at USTC in China. So they came up with a classical spoofing of Google's experiment, which takes just a few seconds on a supercomputer or on multiple, you know, various graphic cards and so on. And they managed to get essentially the same, you know, output from the same kind of distribution. You know, it really does spoof it in a reasonable kind of sense. Now, so there are two things you might say to this. You know, one is you might say, well, you know, it's classical spoofing, but you know, obviously this classical spoofing looks nothing at all like the experimental setup that Google had. So in a sense, you know, yes, it's classical spoofing. The other thing you might say is, well, you know, you could increase from 52 to, you know, you could increase the number of qubits by 20 or 30, and then this may not be so easily spoofable. You know, that's a little bit, I'm not sure how well that works out. But there's an even more interesting sort of refutation, which is Gao et al. Actually refuted the Aronson gun hypothesis. So this was a very recent paper in the last, I think, month or two, which showed that, in fact, you know, this hypothesis saying that you cannot tell whether a string is below median or above median probability in the output distribution of the random quantum circuit, that you cannot do it with, you know, you cannot distinguish with probability better than exponential in n. That's not true. That there's a technique which seems to get you, you know, a distinction with probability exponentially small in the depth of the circuit. And so, you know, so at this point, one would say, well, maybe Google achieved their claims, but it's not very convincing at all. You know, that there's much more that needs to be done to actually show that this is true. At the same time, there was the original proposals by Aronson and Arkhipov that started this whole race off based on boson sampling. And the same, you know, a team at USTC actually claimed that they had run these boson sampling experiments now very well with about now something like 72 bosons and, you know, and this gave you, you know, a different route, which was more convincing. At which point Google sort of returned the favor by giving a classical spoofing of this boson sampling experiment. Now, of course, the boson sampling experiment had a weakness, which is that this Aronson gun hypothesis was known not to hold for that experiment. So the kinds of claims one could make were not quite as strong for that. Okay, so the main takeaway from all this is that this whole quantum supremacy, it's not a one and done. It's a, you know, that one should really view it more like this, you know, these Bell inequality violations, you know, this, you know, these experiments that have happened over the last 40, 50 years since John Bell, where they are done with more and more precision and more, you know, until a few years ago, there was an announcement of the so-called loophole-free Bell inequality tests. So you know, in a similar way, it seems to me that, you know, this is a important scientific experiment that must be refined over time to eliminate these loopholes. And this actually involves many aspects, you know, both experiment as well as theory. And so just to say a little bit about the challenges ahead, you know, there's so where are we in terms of quantum computing today? Well, it's very clear that we are at really, you know, the field is at its infancy. The experiments are at a very preliminary stage where they are still scaling up the number of qubits. The output fidelity is still quite low. There's a lot of work to be done there. there's a lot of work to be done in terms of benchmarking, in terms of error correction, you know, understanding what the sources of the noise are in these qubits, and how to get to more fault tolerant quantum computing, so that you can actually do these computations for depth much more than 20. And of course, there's another thing where there's a big challenge, which is quantum algorithms. So we really, you know, if we had much larger scale quantum computers with higher fidelity, we'd still need to know how to design algorithms for those. Let me just say that in terms of where we are today, so for example, one thing to come out of this experiment from 2 years ago is that this random circuit sampling is now used as a method of benchmarking. So in other words, when you design a quantum computer in the lab, you really want to understand what do the errors look like in that quantum computer. And you want to understand how big those errors are. But beyond that, you also want to understand what's the nature of those errors. So there was a claim that the Google paper made, which at that time seemed you know, sort of far-fetched. What they said was that if they plotted out, if they looked at the data they got through this cross entropy, this linear cross entropy that they measured, it was consistent with saying that the noise in their device affected each of the qubits separately. You know, it was independently. So it wasn't the case that the noise affected, you know, there was correlated noise that affected lots of qubits. That would be much harder to deal with than if the noise was independent on the different qubits. So there was a recent paper that showed something very nice. What it said was basically that if you wanted to understand what the noise looked like in your quantum circuit, then you could perform some sort of random circuit sampling based, you could use an algorithm based on random circuit sampling to analyze the noise, and you could not only infer the total error that your circuit was subjected to, but from that you could actually give formal evidence that in this Google experiment that the noise was actually independent on the different qubits. So this was a way of reaching into the device and sort of saying we can now understand that the noise is actually there's evidence that the noise is independent. Okay, so this was a very nice thing. Okay, so now if we wanted to go beyond this kind of this kind of random circuit sampling based approach, we might say, well, there might be some reason to believe that you cannot duplicate those results classically, but it's not that satisfying. So how do we go beyond that? And especially, there's one way of doing this, which is really completely obvious, right? Which is you just use Shor's factoring algorithm. So you create a challenge problem, you choose a number n at random, which is product of two primes, ask the quantum computer to factorize n, and then just multiply it to see if you got the correct, got back n. The problem is we have no idea, we don't think we are going to be close to being able to implement something like this for large enough n for a very long time, right? For this to happen, you would need a very large number of qubits, a very large number of steps. You know, that's something we don't expect to get to for a very long time. And so in their paper, Arons and Arkhipov sort of said, you don't want to be doing this, right? It's a little bit like proving a dolphin's intelligence by teaching it to solve arithmetic problems. You know, this was the reason why we should be trying to find the kinds of problems that quantum computers are natively good at. Okay, so how do we do this kind of how do we prove that our quantum computer is indeed quantum? But beyond this, how do we do this as we scale up the number of qubits, and without using a classical supercomputer to solve an exponentially hard problem, like for that small n? So there's one approach which is, which seems to, which suggests that, okay, so what's the problem with trying to do this? One is that your quantum computer is a little bit like a black box. It doesn't give out much information. But the second problem is that it can be exponentially powerful, and that's the whole point of it. We want to run it in those regimes where it's exponentially powerful. And so there's one thing that we can make use of, which is that even though it can be exponentially powerful in solving certain problems, there are other problems where it doesn't have an advantage. And specifically, there are problems, there's post-quantum cryptography, there are classical crypto systems where even, which can be implemented classically, but even quantum computers can operate them, right? What this means is that if you have the secret key, you can decrypt messages classically, but a quantum computer cannot decrypt. Okay, so now what we'd like to do is use this kind of post-quantum cryptography to level this playing field. And there are two ways of, there's a wrong way to do it, which is you just cripple the quantum computer by forcing it to decrypt, and that's not much good. The right way is you want to allow the quantum computer to actually exercise, its quantum capabilities while giving the verifier an advantage in actually verification. So there's a simple protocol called a qubit certification protocol that you can implement using this kind of crypto. And what it does is it allows the quantum computer to set up a qubit in a random state. It's either an equal superposition of 0 and 1 with phase B equal to 0, or it's an opposite superposition of 0 and 1. So it's either in the plus state or in the minus state, each with probability half. But the quantum computer, even though it sets up this superposition, it really doesn't know what this phase is. And so as far as it's concerned, it's 50% probability of being in the plus state and 50% in the minus state. And that's indistinguishable from a truly random qubit. But what the quantum computer knows is the encryption of B. And it can tell the verifier this encryption, and the verifier can use the knowledge of this secret to figure out B. So what is this based on? It's based on a very simple notion from cryptography called trapdoor claw free functions. So it's a one-way function. It's a function which is 2 to 1. It's easy to compute, but it's, if f of x naught is y, then there's an x1 such that f of x1 is y. And it's one where it's very hard to find such a claw, x naught, x1, and y. So with knowledge of the trapdoor, you can, given y, you can compute x naught and x1, but without knowledge of the trapdoor, you cannot find such a claw. So based on, you can implement these protocol, which this qubit certification protocol is something very simple. It sort of works on this property that so the verifier sends the trapdoor claw free function to the prover. The prover sends back a Y. The verifier sends back a challenge, either asking for a pre-image X0 or X1, or asking for an equation connecting X0 and X1. Get back either X or this other value D. Now, there's the following, you know, there are the following two things you can show about this. One, the quantum computer can answer either challenge. There's no polynomial time classical or quantum computer that can answer both challenges. Okay. And so given one and two, you can actually argue that there's no classical computer that can successfully answer either challenge. Right? So, and the reason is because the classical computer can be rewound. So if it's willing to answer either challenge, then what you can do is you can proceed through this protocol, but just remember the internal state of the classical computer after it committed to Y. And now you restore the classical computer to the state it was in at that point and give it the other challenge. So if it's willing to answer either challenge, it must be actually willing to answer both. And we just said no polynomial time classical or quantum computer can answer both challenges, right? So this is this interesting notion that you know, in quantum mechanics, we don't have the notion of a trajectory. So you know, if you're doing the double slit experiment, you remember if you have a photon, you know, it can go through either slit one or slit two. But you cannot say which slit it went through. You have no notion of a trajectory that this photon have. There's no history to it. So what that corresponds to in terms of computation is that there's no notion of a trace of a program. If you're going to run quantum programs, there's just no tracing what happened, right? And so if we are going to be debugging quantum programs, we have to think about them differently, and we have to think about how do we reach into these quantum programs and reason about them? Okay. And so that's the sort of thing that these primitives start building up. Okay, so let me just spend 2 minutes saying how does the quantum algorithm actually do this? So for those of you who know about Simon's algorithm, it really follows that. Right, so what you do is you start off in a superposition over all n bit strings. You compute f of x. You measure f of x. You know that's the y that you commit to, and now you're in an equal superposition over the two pre-images. So now, if you're given the challenge zero, you give me a pre-image, then you just measure this in the standard basis, and if you're asked for an equation, you measure it in the Hadamard basis. And you obtain a random string D such that D inner product with X0 plus X1 is zero. So that's an equation tying X0 and X1. Okay, so now here's where there's a few things to say. So in the case that, you know, so we said the classical prover can be rewound, so it can answer either, you know, it can answer both challenges, which means it can output a pre-image as well as this equation D, right? D such that D times X0 plus X1 is zero. Right? So, but that's just one, you know, that's just one bit about X0 and X1. And so we don't get both X0 and X1 through this, just one of the pre-images and a bit about X0 and X1. So the fact that even this is impossible to do is based on this new kind of hardcore bit property for LWE, which is called this adaptive hardcore bit. And this comes about because, you know, there's this beautiful theory for LWE called leakage resistance, which allows you to really get at, you know, which parts of the LWE function are hard. And it's really very powerful. Okay, so there's another thing you can do with this kind of these kinds of protocols, which is you can generate random numbers, but with this property that even though you don't trust this the quantum device that's generating these random numbers, you can actually certify that the output is statistically random. And in fact, it even looks statistically random to any adversary who might be entangled with this quantum device. So you know, this requires really reaching into this quantum device and characterizing the state of that qubit in there. Now there's much more you can do with these kinds of primitives, and there are these two really beautiful applications due to Urmila Mahde. So the first one has to do with the fact that we expect quantum computers, you know, when they are scaled up and when they are really can really do something useful, to be used in the cloud. So now you might want to delegate a quantum computation to it, and you might want to keep your data private. So can you do that as a classical, you know, can your classical computer sort of delegate this computation in a way that you can actually test that you've got the correct answer, where you sort of get the correct answer. And so that's this quantum fully homomorphic encryption. And then the second question is one about verification of quantum computation. So let's say that you had some kind of quantum computation you wanted to carry out, which was not like factoring, where when you get the answer, you can actually check efficiently, classically, that you got the right answer. But so suppose there's some quantum computation where the answer is succinct, but you also don't want to trust that your quantum computer was either correctly calibrated or you know, that it wasn't adversarial. How do you verify the correctness of the output of a quantum computer? So there's this beautiful protocol showing that you can actually do this. Okay, so there's actually a different way of seeing this that Giorgio and Vidic actually showed, which may be a little more accessible given what I've told you about. So let me just say that bit. So there was a protocol of Fitzsimmons and Kashefi who had shown that if the classical verifier can force a quantum device to prepare one of eight states, you know, the eight states being not the two superpositions I told you, the plus and the minus, but now let omega be an eighth root of unity. And now the eight states correspond to the eighth roots of unity, you know, in the phase between zero and one. So if you can force the quantum device to prepare these eight states, then you can verify an arbitrary quantum computation. And so what Giorgio and Vidic show is that, in fact, you can take the qubit certification protocol and you can modify it by adding one more idea to it, which is using the so-called quantum random access codes to prove rigidity. And now you can actually force the quantum computer to create one of these eight states at random, where the quantum computer doesn't know this, what the quantum computer can tell you is D, right, which is the encryption of this number mod eight. And so now the verifier knows what this state is, but the prover is just creating a random one of these. And so when you plug this into the Fitzsimmons-Kashefi protocol, you can verify quantum computations. Okay. There was another version of this, these tests of, you know, scalable tests of random quantumness, which we gave, where which was sort of interesting because what it did was it sort of put together two different concepts. You know, one was this interaction with a single polynomial time quantum device, right? This is the setting that we've been looking at. There was another setting in which we had shown how to perform these kinds of tests, which was where you have two different quantum devices which are entangled and which are spatially separated, so they can't communicate with each other. And so there was a modification of this qubit certification test, which incorporated this kind of bell test within it, where the space-like separation between these two players was replaced by this computational hardness of a crypto problem. And then this was used to show that there's a variant of this protocol which actually works even without this adaptive hard qubit test. Now, what that does is it means that you don't have to limit yourself to LWE. You can use even cryptography like the X squared mod n, trapped claw free function, which is based on factoring. But you know, since we are doing a test of quantumness, we don't need for this cryptography to be post quantum. And so, very recently, there was a proof of concept implementation of both of these schemes. You know, the one with the adaptive hard qubit and the one without. On an ion trap quantum computer. This was a small proof of concept with about 20 qubits. The innovation there was that in order to do this, run this protocol, you don't only have to do a computation, you actually have to do an intermediate measurement and commit to the Y and then get a challenge and do another measurement. And so, that's the kind of thing that requires some innovation, because the first measurement usually disturbs the system enough that you can't continue to do a computation from there. And so, for this to be a genuine proof of quantumness, of course, this would have to be, this would have to be scaled up to hundreds of qubits. And these ion trap quantum computers are not there yet. And, it was just a proof of concept without actually giving an actual proof of quantumness. There are other variants on this that you can actually do. So for example, there's a variant on this basic qubit certification protocol, where you can show that in one round of it, instead of generating a single bit of randomness, you can actually generate n bits of randomness in that single round. What this allows you to do is it's also a way of testing that your quantum computer has n qubits of memory. And this is based on these leakage resilient techniques from LWE to choose instead of a 2-to-1 function, this claw free function, you now have a 2-to-the-k-to-1 function. And so let me, I think I'm at the end of my time. So let me just do wrap up with this one slide. So where are we today with quantum computing? I think that really we are the at its, the field is at its infancy in many, many different aspects, So in terms of experiments, what exists is proof of concepts, right? Because right now the number of qubits is very small. It's, you know, the fidelity is quite low on the qubits, so you cannot really have the, you know, you don't get, you know, your answers are very noisy. And but on the other hand, what's true is that there's a huge amount of resources that have been poured into experiments, both in terms of both from you know, both from federal sources as well as from private industry. But more than that, there are these teams of people who are looking at these experiments from much more interesting viewpoints, you know, where they are thinking out of the box in terms of how to organize these experiments. So there's for example this work on tweezer arrays based on Rydberg atoms from Misha Lukin's lab, which is the experiment goes back only a few years ago, and it's already, you know, it's already been scaled up to a couple of hundred qubits. But for implementing physics experiment, you know, sort of implementing certain experiments in physics. There's also, a lot of advances in benchmarking and fault tolerance, but again, we are still at the infancy. And then there's, as I said before, quantum algorithms where again, there's a need to invest a lot more effort if you are going to, if we take the existing quantum algorithms, which are in principle, we know they exist in principle, but how do they actually, you know, do we actually have concrete quantum algorithms that we could be implementing if we did have a quantum computer? Now, there's the second aspect which I touched on when I started, where I said, you know, computation represents much more than calculating things. It's a lens through which we view the world. And so quantum computation actually represents a major change in perspective. And that has been incredibly influential already. So, you know, that kind of perspective has already been quite revolutionary in condensed matter physics and in quantum gravity, you know, where concepts of quantum error correction as well as concepts from cryptography, you know, have played a very big role in shaping those areas. And then the third thing is that this testing quantum mechanics in this limit of high complexity, this is a fundamental experiment in science. And I think it's an experiment that'll be repeated over the next years and possibly decades, you know, until we get something that's really loophole free. Okay, so let me stop there.
Great, thanks. So maybe I'll open it up now for questions. You can either write your question in the chat or just unmute yourself and speak if you'd like.
So one question, so you've focused on, we're currently at this state where we're trying to figure out how to verify these, that we've really got this quantum supremacy, right? You've outlined many different aspects, different approaches to try to do that, and how you're refining those approaches from the quantum. So that's for computation. What about on the cryptography side, where cryptography uses quantumness in its properties? Where does that stand relative to computation in terms of our confidence and how it's working and how well things are going there?
Well, you know, with respect to cryptography, there are really two different things we can look at. You know, one is post-quantum crypto, which is classical cryptography, which is immune to quantum attacks. And there things are, NIST has held a challenge. You know, there was a NIST challenge to pick a successor to RSA, you know, a public key crypto system that would be the successor, and that would be post-quantum secure. So they are at a pretty late stage in that competition. And at the moment, there's quite a bit of confidence in LWE and its variants, but there are still attempts to try to break that using quantum algorithms. And I think for the moment, what NIST is leaning towards, or maybe they have already decided to do, is to not come up with one standard, but to say, look, here's what we are going with for the moment, but we'll revisit it in a little while. I shouldn't say for sure, because I'm sure I'm garbling what their recommendation is, but okay. So that's on the one side, and post-quantum crypto is being seen as probably the more more scalable option. You know, it's something that which doesn't require quantum computers to begin with, or any new hardware to begin with. Then there's quantum cryptography, right, where you actually are sending information using qubits, usually photons. Now, that has been exhibited over large distances in somewhat specialized settings. But again, in all of that, there's the issue of how well, there are various kinds of attacks that you can imagine on those systems. And so there's a notion of cryptography called, there's a formulation of it, which is called device independent quantum cryptography, where you assume that your quantum devices that are performing this quantum cryptography are themselves adversarial. So you regard them as black boxes and that are untrusted. And so, for the longest time, it was not known whether you could implement your quantum cryptography in that model and if it would be secure. And in fact, some of the earliest work on certifiable quantum randomness was inspired by those questions. And then the work in certifiable randomness in that setting, where you had two such devices which shared entanglement and which were far apart, couldn't communicate, that you could extract randomness from it. So it was a step beyond that, to show that in fact you could do quantum key distribution, because that's like extracting randomness, but it's the same randomness on both sides, and an adversary shouldn't be able to get any information. And so we do know how to do device independent quantum cryptography, since that was shown, there have been much nicer, versions of it, which are much more efficient. So there are even some experiments that have demonstrated it, but I'm not up on whether my guess is these are not yet practical. So if you really want that kind of security, so in other words, what happens is you do get unconditional security, but then you also end up with new kinds of attacks. And so if you want to deter these new kinds of attacks, you have to now switch to this model, which is device independence. Even though theoretically everything works out and there are even proofs of concept that have been implemented, I don't think those, okay, so I may not be up on the latest on that, but I think last I saw, they were not yet, practically feasible. So it depends upon what one wants to be, you know, what kind of assumptions one wants to live at.
Thanks.
So thanks again, Umesh, for a very nice talk. And thank you all for attending.